Hello, Junction City Today fans. I'm Craig Bielik, your host, and I'm joined today with Eli Anderson, and we're going to talk about wagons. How much do you guys know about wagons? I know literally nothing about wagons, Eli, but Eli is the proper term wagon master? I mean,
I've been one of those before, but...
Yeah? You're like an expert in wagons.
Well, we have quite a few of them, and I don't know I think the experts are gone, but we try to do the best we can.
But you're as close to an expert probably as still exists in this world, I would imagine. You've got an event coming up. We're going to talk about that in a little while. The 12th annual conference of the Freight Wagon Association, if I'm reading that right. Is that right?
The National Stagecoach and Freight Wagon Association.
Right on. Well, let's start at the start. Let's get the little beginning. You grew up in this area-ish, right?
Well, I grew up in the Tremonton area.
Uh-huh.
And still growing up, but
not grown yet, Craig.
Yeah. But did spend some time here in Ogden. Used to go to the Ogden Union Stockyards every week with my dad during the summers, and the livestock shows that were handled there. So spent quite a bit of time.
Those are probably good memories for you, huh?
They're good memories, and when I drive down where the stockyards used to be, it makes me think, boy, things have really changed. And it probably dates me a lot.
It really does. But it also dates a lot of our viewers, too, because a lot of people out there know exactly what you're talking about. And I have memories of going down the stockyard with my grandparents and seeing all that. And, yeah, we really have changed. Ogden was one of the largest hubs for livestock in the West.
That's correct.
And that all changed about the early 70s or something like that, right?
That's when it started too.
Right. So I want to talk about wagons.
Okay.
Because I've been told you have probably the largest collection of wagons in the world. Is that correct? Wagons.
I don't think you can go anywhere and find a bigger variety of different types of horse-drawn vehicles than what we have.
Is that right?
Uh-huh.
And so you've got some property up in Tremonton where those are located, right?
I mean, a little bit.
You don't keep them in the house or anything like that.
Storage is a problem though, because they do take quite a bit of room to store. And
right.
Maybe I should have started out with thimbles and teaspoons, something like that.
A lot easier to collect those, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
How many wagons do you think you have?
Oh, we think we're getting upwards of 350 probably.
350, mm-hmm. Full size.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Pretty much full size. There are some that are smaller, but we've got some pony size and all different types that they had back in the day. And one of my favorite wagons, I have to tell you a little bit about one of my favorite wagons.
Sure, absolutely.
It's a wagon that I had my eye on for a lot of years, and the fellow that owned it wasn't willing to part with it. And I actually had to outlive him to get the wagon.
Yeah.
And it took me 15 years to get it.
Wow.
And after we got the wagon, my wife was helping me push it into the shop, and it broke in half the front wheels from the back wheels. It was so broke down and dilapidated. And I spent 18 months restoring that wagon. And I got close to being finished with the wood part, and I was getting ready to paint it.
Uh-huh.
And, I put it back rivet for rivet, screw for screw, same species of wood as what had been there originally.
Wow.
And... because I wanted it to be just perfect like it was when it was new and in use. So I called the lady I'd got it from, and I said, are there any old pictures? Did it ever have any writing on it or anything? And she says, no, I never saw it when it had writing on it. But she said it was owned by a company in Ogden called Coal Transfer and Storage.
Okay.
And they were just down the street.
Really?
And they made deliveries from here at the railroad.
And to Tremonton in a wagon.
Well, no, they delivered to the businesses.
Oh, okay, around.
So they would deliver the freight. It's a kind of a hitch wagon, kind of like the Budweiser wagon.
Yeah.
And so they would deliver that freight. Well, my wife's grandfather was in his 80s, and he was up to see us, and this is many, many years ago. And I said, Grandpa, do you know anything about coal transfer and storage? Oh, yes, he says. That was owned by my uncle.
Oh, wow.
And they had six of these wagons, and I used to drive for him.
Oh, you're kidding me.
And so, I mean, by golly, here was a wagon that was,
it was destined to be yours.
In the family. Well, when they went to motorized vehicles here in Ogden, they were a little bit ahead of where they were in Tremonton. And there was a fellow in Tremonton that acquired the wagon, and he was a horse trader. And he would go from Logan to Brigham to Tremonton every week with a string of horses tied behind this wagon, and he would trade horses all over the valley.
Really?
Cache Valley and the Box Elder County area. Well, he was my mother's uncle. So this wagon has either been on my wife's side of the family or my side of the family since it was new.
Wow. It's the wagon of destiny.
It's
I mean, that could make a Hallmark movie out of that.
Yeah,
hey, I got the rights to that, Hallmark. If you're out there and you're watching, I just patented that right now. How did you get started collecting wagons, and why wagons?
Well, you know, when I was in second grade, we went on a field trip to Pioneer Village.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, to get to Pioneer Village, we had to go to Ogden Union Station, and we had to board the train, and we rode the train to Salt Lake City, and then the bus was at the station in Salt Lake, and they picked us up and took us up to Pioneer Village.
Mm-hmm.
That was before it was located at Lagoon. And as my mother was taking me through Pioneer Village, she'd say, oh, that cream separator is just like the one we used to have. And, you know, we had to crank that, and it had all these discs you had to wash, and what a job that was. And then she saw, well, there's the old pump organ. That's like the pump organ we used to have.
Wow.
And the parlor stove. And then we went outside, and she says, there's the white top buggy. My neighbors had a white top buggy just like that. So I came home from there, and I wanted to find these things that, you know, she was telling me about that she'd grown up with. And I discovered that most of those things had been discarded over the riverbank. And so that made me feel bad. And so I started bringing home broken pieces of purple glass and pottery. And, you know, I was working on old furniture and saving old furniture the landfill. And actually, I started looking at that, and I go, well, a chest of drawers back then is the same as one today, the same use, and those things are being preserved and saved. But the horse-drawn vehicles weren't.
Mm-hmm.
And they were going to ruin, and they were out on the rocky knolls. People in Utah weren't established early enough to put them into sheds and take care of them. And so I said, you know, I've got to get a buggy. And I got my first buggy. You know, I didn't even have a driver's license when I got my first
really?
One. And I and I started restoring it, and went and found an original one that was more complete, and got all the dimensions and measurements and things like that off of, and started restoring that buggy. And you know, I spent $500 to get the wheels rebuilt, and that was like my life savings, and that was a lot of money to me.
Yeah.
And so
back
you know,
in the day, that was a huge amount of money.
And then I got committed, you know, to really, you know, doing it, and I got it finished. And when I got that finished, I realized, you know, all buggies weren't the same, and there were so many different types out there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started trying to find and preserve and restore different styles of wagons, and it grew from that second grade field trip to Pioneer Village.
No kidding, yeah. No kidding. You know, my next question was going to be, you know, why do you do this? But you just explained it in total why you do it, and I can tell you're passionate about it. So you're married, Eli?
Yes.
Okay. How's your wife feel about having 300 buggies or whatever?
I don't know that we've told her yet.
She hasn't noticed. Yeah. they're just out there. And it sounds like you are really committed to making sure the craft and everything there is still preserved. That you you mentioned getting the same species of wood and making sure all the rivets were back in there. This is not an easy thing. How do you learn this stuff?
Yeah, there's no plywood.
You go to buggy school. They offer a degree at Weber State or something.
No, they don't. And you know, that's been a learning curve. But I have to tell you that I was trained by the masters.
No kidding.
Because I would take the work of the masters that originally built it.
Uh huh.
And I would try to duplicate exactly what they had done, and so that was the training that I've got. There's a wheelwright school that's available out there. I really didn't go to a wheelwright school, but I went to a fellow that taught a wheelwright school, and he said, "Eli, if you bring some wheels up here, and if they just need to replace a spoke or a piece of felly, and if you don't bother me from the work I'm doing, you can come up and do that." And he'd give me a few pointers. And so I went up and fixed 14 wheels that way.
Yeah.
Didn't build a complete thing, but I learned the kind of tooling. I learned what it took to do that. And I came home and I built up the tooling that I needed to do that project. And from that tooling, then I was able to actually build a set of wheels without really being trained
really
there at my place. And So, yeah, we've made quite a few wheels, restored them. And
wow. This is an expensive hobby, I would imagine.
Yeah, if you know, I think about it, you know, if I would have been someone that was blessed with a lot of money, what the collection could have been.
Yeah.
But it's been, you know, a couple of boards here and a can of paint and a few screws, and it's been built upon a little at a time, but it's been steady.
Acquired over a process of years. Okay, so here comes the next obvious question. People are out there watching right now, and they're like going, I want to see these. How can I check this out? Is there a way?
Yes, they can go to the website. It's wagonlandadventure.com.
Okay, right there on the screen.
If they go to that website, they'll find my phone number there, and they can give me a call, make an appointment. So I'll be there for sure, and we'll take them on a tour and show them the wagons.
Go up and show them. Now,
one other thing we're going to be doing on May 6th, we're having an open house and inviting the public to come, and we have some railroad memorabilia that we're going to be sharing with the public for Golden Spike Week.
Wow.
And we also have Mark Hopkins' buggy, and Mark Hopkins was the principal financier of the Transcontinental Railroad for the Central Pacific Railroad.
Really?
If it wasn't for Mark Hopkins, we may not have been driving a Golden Spike.
Yeah, yeah.
So
he was the money guy behind it.
He was
all,
the money guy, very important. There was him, Leland Stanford, Huntington. So they were part of the Big Four. And so, you know, he died in the late 1870s, and so we have his buggy. And it was on display for a few years out to the Golden Spike National Historic Site. And in Promontory for a while.
Wow.
But anyway, there's also a railroad dump cart that they use to build the railroad grade in the West.
Wow.
And so that's a very, very old piece as well, and that will be on display along with all the other wagons and things that are there in the collection. But some of the things we're, you know, we'll showcase a little bit is the railroad memorabilia that's in the collection.
That's cool. And when you say there's different types of wagons, I mean, you know, like I say, I don't know anything about wagons. Yes, I do. I know one type of wagon, the radial flyer. That's the wagon I know. Do you have any of those?
I do, but okay. I don't have the metal ones.
Yeah.
You know, they built wooden ones with wood spokes prior to the radial flyer.
Oh, hey, that would be worth seeing alone. But what are some kinds of wagons? I mean, you got, I don't know, wooden wagon, covered wagon,
you know,
on the wagon, off the wagon.
Basically, they had wagons for just about every purpose you can think of. I mean, we've got a popcorn wagon. We've got stagecoaches. We've got freight wagons. In fact, we've got a freight wagon, an actual freight wagon that was used to haul freight from Corinne to Montana.
Wow.
And it's quite a relic, but we have it there in the collection. There's laundry wagons. There's furniture moving wagons. There's a wagon that they used to deliver pies and baked goods and you know, you can go on and on of different types, belly dumps, lumber wagons.
Belly dumps, that's my favorite. Yeah. So far, belly dump. A belly dump. Do you know, I'm just curious, do you know the story of Brigham Young's wagon and how it relates to Ogden?
But you'll have to tell me.
I'm not on the air, but I will tell you off the air because it's pretty interesting story. Yeah.
Well, I'd like to hear that.
Now, what else do you want to know about wagons, all you guys out there? Because we got the master right here. He's having a public event, and there's also an opportunity for you. I'm really thinking about taking my grandchildren out to see some wagons. I mean, how often would someone get a chance to do this? So here's the website right here. Eli, what else do you want to tell us about wagons?
I want to tell you about a parade.
A parade, wagon parade.
There's going to be an all-horse parade on May 4th in Brigham City.
Oh, cool.
And that parade is going to showcase a lot of wagons. And it's the opening ceremony for Golden Spike Week.
Wow.
And it's all horses, no motorized vehicles.
Right.
Like and, you know, they've got an awful lot of interest in it. I think it'll be something that you won't want to miss.
Definitely. So check that out, too. May 4th, right, in Brigham City.
May 4th, Brigham City.
In the evening, I would imagine.
It'll probably be around 11 o'clock, 10:30, 11 o'clock.
Oh, because May 4th is a Saturday.
It's on a Saturday.
I think about it. Right, right. Well, there you have it, folks. My guest today, Eli Anderson. I learned way more about wagons than I ever thought I would, and I'll bet you did, too. We really appreciate you watching Junction City today. Eli, we're going to have you back on again. We got to get you out here before May 4th so that you can so we can talk more wagons. I need to learn more about wagons. Until that time, you guys take it easy, and we'll see you on Junction City Today. Anytime you tune in, we're ready for you.
Thank you.